إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا أما بعد معاشر المسلمين أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله سبحانه وتعالى إن شاء الله today in our khutbah we are going to discuss about one very important surah that is Surah Al-Kahf. As we are all aware that as Muslims from the traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, each one of us is supposed to be reciting Surah Al-Kahf every Friday. And regarding this particular surah, waradat fiha ahadithun kathira tadullu ala fadli hadhihi surah. There are so many ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which explains the virtues and importance of this surah. One of these ahadith fi sahihain an al-Barra bin Azib radiyallahu anhu. This hadith is recorded in the two sahih, Sahih al-Bukhari as well as Sahih al-Muslim. Reporting from Barra bin Azib radiyallahu anhu, qal baynama rajulun من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقرأ هذه السورة. براء بن عازب رضي الله عنه says, once upon a time, one of the companions of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم was reciting this particular surah, سورة الكهف. وفرس مربوط في الدار, and there was a horse which was tied next to his house. فَجَعَلَ يَنْفِرُ أَيْ الْفَرَسِ. Then what happened, as this man by the name of Usaid bin Khudayr radiallahu anhu, while he was reciting the surah, the horse outside there was began to become what? Unsettled. جَعَلَ يَنْفِرُ الْفَرَسِ فَخَرَجَ الرَّجُلُ فَنَظَرَ فَلَمْ يَرَ شَيْءٍ. While in the house, Usaid bin Khudayr, he had the movements of the horse. Then he felt perhaps there's somebody, maybe there's an intruder in the house. So he came outside to find out what was happening to the horse. فَلَمْ يَجِدْ شَيْئًا. He couldn't see anything except the horse which was standing there. فَجَعَلَ يَقْرَأُ وَالْفَرَسُ يَنْفِرُ. When he went back in his house, he continued the recitation of the Quran, and the horse, the same thing happened to the horse. فَلَمَّا أَصْبَحَ ذَهَبَ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَذَكَرَ ذَلِكَ لَهُ. In the morning, Usayd bin Khudayr radiallahu anhu, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he informed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the incident which he experienced the previous night. فَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, "Tilka as-sakinatu tanazzalat bil Qur'an." The Prophet informed him that whatever that made the horse to be restless, tilka as-sakinah, that is tranquility tatanazzalu bil Qur'an, which comes down with the recitation of the Holy Quran. In a different narration, فيما يرويه مسلم في صحيحه عن أبي الدرداء رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من حفظ 10 آيات من أول سورة الكهف أصم من الدجال. The second virtue of this surah, specifically this surah, Imam Muslim رحمه الله reporting from Al-Barra Abu Darda radiallahu anhu that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من حفظ عشر آيات من سورة الكهف أسلم من الدجال. Whoever who shall memorize the 10 verses of this surah, Surah Al-Kahf, then this person is going to be protected from Masih al-Dajjal. Third hadith talking about the virtues of this surah, Imam Ahmad fi musnadihi yarwi an Mu'adh an Abihi radiyallahu an. Ar-Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam anahu qal, man qara'a awwala surat al-kahf wa akhiraha كانت له نورا من قدمه إلى رأسه ومن قرأها كلها كانت له نورا ما بين السماء والأرض. In this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whoever who shall recite awwal surah, the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf, then this person will have what? He will have light that will brighten him. Min qadamihi, from his foot, ila ra'sihi, up to his head. Wa man qara'aha kullaha, and whoever who shall recite the surah from the beginning to the end, the entire surah, kanat lahu nuran ma bayna as-sama'i wal ard. Because of this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give him what? Lightning, ma bayna as-sama'i, from the earth up till the heavens. These are some of the virtues of this surah. But respected elders and brothers in Islam, تحتوي هذه السورة على أربع قصص. One of the main reasons why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam categorically he chose that it's upon each and every Muslim to recite this surah on each and every Friday. What are the lessons that we need to learn from this surah? Because the recitation doesn't necessarily mean that you only recite the surah, but you also have to ponder in each and every teaching, each and every ayah, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala require from us. In this surah, there are four different stories which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is narrating to the believers. We are trying to look at the similarity or comparison. Why did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam chose and said that reciting this surah each and every Friday will cause us to get what? Protection from Masih al-Dajjal. We all know about Masih al-Dajjal. He's one of the 10 major signs of Qiyamah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, لَن تَقُومَ السَّاعَةَ حَتَّى تَرَوْ قَبْلَهَا عَشَرَ عَلَامَاتٍ وَذَكَرَ مِنْهَا خُرُوج المسيح الدجال. One of the 10 signs, major signs of Qiyamah, is the appearance of this Dajjal. And the Prophet here is saying that if you recite Surah Al-Kahf, then you are going to be protected from Masih al-Dajjal. What is the relationship between Surah Al-Kahf and the appearance of the Dajjal that will cause us to get protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against this Dajjal? The four stories. Story number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Kahf, he is narrating to us about the story of the people of the cave. He says, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا. Do you think that the story or the event that happened to the people of the cave and the people of the inscriptions, do you think that these two stories, كان من آياتنا عجبا, these were wonders amongst our signs? These are not the only wonders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In short, we are not going to narrate the whole story, but just in a nutshell, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about these fitya, إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. These are few young men who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They lived in a time whereby those people of the time, they were what? They were mushrikun. Then for these young men, they became afraid of their faith, of their iman. Then what happened when the environment was not conducive for them? It was so hostile to them. What they did, they decided to go away from the village and they sought refuge. They went to hide themselves inside a cave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Am hasibata anna ashab al-kahfi wal-raqibi. Do you think that their story is the most wonderful thing that Allah is able to do? No. Because for these young men, they lived in the cave for 309 years, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them life again, and they came out and they interacted with the people of that village, and those were among the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Story number two, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is narrating to us in this surah, Qissatu Sahib al-Jannatain. The story of a person who possessed two gardens. The owner of the two gardens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَضُرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الرَّجُلَيْنِ جَعَلْنَا لِأَحَدِهِمَا جَنَّتَيْنِ مِنْ عَنَابٍ وَحَفَفْنَاهُمَا بِنَخْلٍ وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمَا زَرْعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instructing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, give them the example of the person who owned two gardens, jannatayn. For these two gardens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, min a'nab, from grapes. Wahafafnahuma binakhlin, we surrounded the two gardens of this person, binakhlin, with palm trees. Waja'alna baynahuma zar'a, and beneath or in the middle of these two gardens, we made what? Green crops to grow. But then this person, what he did? He transgressed. Looking at the ni'mah which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed him with, what did he say? He said, وَمَا أَذُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمَةً. I don't think the qiyamah shall come. وَلَئِن رُدِدْتُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي لَأَجِدَنَّ خَيْرًا مِنْهَا مُنْقَلَبًا. Even if I'll be the one to be taken back to my Lord, definitely whatever that I'll find before him is going to be something better for me. But he was doubtful about qiyamah simply because he was mesmerized. He was what? He was convinced that whatever that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed him with, in form of garden, in form of the crops, he felt that perhaps these will never come to an end. The third story is qissa to Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam wa sahibihi al-Khadir alayhi salam. The third story is between the two people, Nabiullah Musa and his companion al-Khadir alayhi salam. When Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam, once when he was addressing his people, then somebody, looking at how Nabi Musa alayhi salam was well informed, he asked him, هل في الأرض أعلم من أعلم أهل الأرض في الدنيا? In this world, who is the most knowledgeable person? Or is there anybody who is more knowledgeable than you, Musa alayhi salam? Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam, responding according to the information that he had, he said, there's nobody well informed than me, because he was Nabiullah at that time. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed him that, no, you're not the most knowledgeable person on the face of the earth. Rather, there's somebody whom you are going to meet, and this person is more knowledgeable than you. Nabi Musa alayhi salam, he was curious. He wanted to meet this most knowledgeable person than him on the face of the earth. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him instructions to go at a certain place whereby he's going to meet this person, and it happened what happened between the two of them. Now the fourth story is Qissatu Dhil Qarnayn. The final story in this surah is the story of Dhil Qarnayn. Dhil Qarnayn was a leader, and this leader, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him both al-ilmu wal-quwwa. Allah gave him, he blessed him with knowledge. Allah blessed him with strength. These are the two most qualities that our leaders need to have. Al-ilmu, you must have knowledge. Al-quwwa, you have to be strong. And for this leader, he was going round and round and round, east and west, north and south, trying to find out what is happening to the people that he is leading. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions his story. And finally, one of the greatest things that this person was able to do, the leader, he was able to resolve the conflict that was there between the people of that time and Ya'juj wa Ma'juj, whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also mentioned as one of the 10 major signs of Qiyamah. Now these are the four main stories. Why do we need to talk about these stories? Why does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has to relate between recitation of this surah, memorizing this surah, and khuruj Masih al-Dajjal and the fitan of Masih al-Dajjal? If you look deeply into these stories, one thing that comes out, of course, there are so many things to talk about. But because of time, we are going to concentrate more on the fitan, on the trials, on the tribulations that have been mentioned from these four surahs, from these four stories. Remember, story number one is about the people of the Kahf. Story number two is about the Sahib al-Jannatayn, the one who had two gardens. Number three, about Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam and Khadir. And number four is about Dhul-Qarnayn. We said, the stories we shall tackle only the fitan. What lessons do we learn from these fitan? Al-fitan, ibadallah. The trials, when you talk of the trials, we have to understand. Trials, al-fitna to ay al-ikhtibaru wal-imtihan. Fitan, these are tests. And from the test, the outcome will either make you understand that that test was ni'mah for you, it was a blessing, or afterwards you come to realize that that test was what? It was niqma. It was what? It was a torment upon you. About the issue of al-fitan, the scholars, they tell us that إذا أقبلت تشابهت وإذا أدبرت تمايزت. About these fitan, they come in a very strange manner. None of us is immune to the fitan. None of us shall never be faced with a fitan. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالْخَيْرِ وَالشَّرِّ فِتْنَةً. We shall put you on trials, be it with the good that we give you or with the bad that befalls you. Understand, all these are forms of what? Al-fitan. Now about fitna, the characteristic is unpredictable. The ulama say, إِذَا أَقْبَلَتْ تَشَابَهَتْ وَإِذَا أَدْبَرَتْ تَمَايَزَتْ. It has got two characteristics. One is that when the fitna approaches, when you are faced with any particular situation, tashabahat, it becomes unclear to you whether the end of it shall be ni'mah or it's going to be niqmah. Wa idha adbarat, once it has gone, then what happens is tamayazat, you are able to differentiate. Now you come to know for certain that whatever that was going through, this was a blessing for me, or whatever that was going through, that was a punishment which was prescribed upon me by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Akhraja Nu'aym bin Hamid rahimahullahu anil Hudhaifah ibn al-Yamani radiallahu anhu. Hudhaifah ibn al-Yamani radiallahu anhu, talking about al-fitan, because he was the most knowledgeable amongst the sahabas regarding al-fitan. Himself, he says that most of my companions, most of the sahabas of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to ask the Prophet about al-khayr, lakin kuntu as'aluhu anishar. Hudhaifah, he would always ask the Prophet, what are the evil things? What are the fitan? Why? Because he knew many people, they will only concentrate on the good part, good side of the dunya, or the good side of the world. But when it comes to the shar, we always try to bury our heads in the sand. Yet we are told, araftu sharra la li sharri lakin li tawaqihi. We need to understand the evils, not for you to be to do what? Not for you to commit that evil, but for you to be wary, for you to be careful, not falling into those evils. Araftu sharra la li sharri lakin li tawaqihi. Fa inna, because مَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفِ الْخَيْرَ مِنَ الشَّرِّ وَقَعَ فِيهِ. If you are not able to distinguish, you are not able to differentiate, you are not able to say clearly, this is al-khayr and this is a shar, you'll definitely find yourself in the shar unknowingly. So Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he says, Al-fitanu thalathun. Fitan has got three levels. Tasuquhum ar-rabi'atu ila ad-dajjal. And the fourth level shall drive people to Masih ad-Dajjal. Then he says, Allati tarmi bil-radhaf, wallati tarmi bil-nashaf, was-sawda'u al-muzlima, wallati tamuju mawj al-bahr. There are four levels of fitan. Allati tarmi bi an-nashaf, ar-radhaf awalan. The one which does what? Ar-radhaf, ahlul lugha, translating or explaining whatever that Hudhayfa meant by ar-radhaf. They say here al-fitanu, these are the fitnas allati la tu'athiru fi adyani nasi li khifatiha. It does not affect our religion, does not affect our faith, but it only affects our what? Our bodies, the physical part of it. Ar-radhaf. Wallati tarmi bi an-nashaf. The second level of fitna is that which does what? Tarmi bi an-nashaf. It affects us in our aqidah, in our belief, in our deen. That is the second level. Then thirdly, he says, was-sawda'ul mudlima. Then there comes fitan that will be continuous, that will have no ending. Then allati tamuju mawj al-bahr. Then finally he says, the next fitna that shall come, that shall befall the human being, tamuju mawj al-bahr. It will be so huge, like the waves of the oceans. He says these are the four different levels of al-fitna. Amma an gharabat al-fitan, the strangeness of the fitan, we said number one is that, idha aqbalat, when it comes to you, tashabahat, it's never clear. Idha adbarat, tamayazat, once it has bypassed you, then it becomes clear to you that that was fitna which was ni'mah, or it was fitna which was a ni'mah. And the ulama again, they say that all the fitan which affect human beings, they are classified into two. One is minash shubuhati wa minash shahawat. Each and every fitna that befalls us, it's out of the two things. One is a shubhat, unclarity. Shubhat, this affects us in our deen. The second one is a shahawat. About the shahawat, these are the desires. Fitan in form of shahwa. Shahwa, these are what is attractive to yourself. Either be it wealth or whatever worldly gains, as long as it's in form of shahwa, this can also be al-fitan. Then, respected brothers, when you look at all these four stories, each one of them is teaching us a lesson regarding fitna. The first story of the people of the cave, this is fitnatun fiddin. In our entire life, we have four different types of fitan, the greatest ones. One is al-fitnatu fiddin. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to draw our attention to. We have to recite this surah every Friday. We have to understand the meaning of this surah. And we have to derive lessons from this surah so that we try to implement them in our daily lives. Each and every Friday we recite this surah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is advising us. He is reminding us. He is calling upon us that all those who recite Surah Al-Kahf each and every Friday understand this fitnatun fiddin. And this is the greatest form of fitna. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another ayah, he tells the believers that Rabbana la taj'alna fitnatan lilladhina kafaru. Oh Allah, do not make us to be trial over those who disbelieved. La taj'alna fitnatan lilqawmi dhalimin. Don't make us to be fitna trials upon the people who are what? Wrongdoers. Qawmi dhalimin. Mufassiruna, when they translate, when they interpret these two ayahs, what do they say? They say it means that you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to allow the disbelievers, the wrongdoers, to overcome you. It was the norm of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he could always supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying la taj'al rabbana la taj'alna allahumma aqsim lana min khashyatika ma tahulu bihi baynana wa bayna ma'asik. To the end of the dua, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say waj'al tha'rana ala man zalamana wala wansurna ala man adana wala taj'al musibatana fi dinina wala taj'al ad-dunya akbara hammina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would always supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying la taj'al fitnatana la taj'al musibatana fi dinina. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do not make our afflictions in our religion. Don't afflict us. Do not put us into trial because of our religion. Any other form of musibah a human being can handle. But the form of musibah that befalls you in your religion, it is the greatest form of musibah. Another fitna, fitnatul mal. In the second story, the people of the person who owned the two gardens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in narrating to us his story, he is warning us about fitnatul mal. One is fitnatul fiddin, number two fitnatul fil mal. You can also be put into trials by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for you. The mal, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding this, he says, innama amwalukum wa awladukum fitna. Both we consider them to be beneficial. Both we consider them to be ni'mah, al-amwalu wal-awladu. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, innama adatu hasr. Innama, indeed, for sure, there's no doubt about it. Amwalukum, the wealth, your possessions, wa awladukum, and your children, fitna. Wallahu indahu ajrun azim. These two, they are forms of what? They are forms of tribulations. Thirdly, in the story of Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam, what lesson do we learn? Fitnatun fil ilmi. Fitna in knowledge. Alhamdulillah, seeking knowledge is obligatory. Whoever who is knowledgeable, this person is given higher ranks in a society by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. Whoever who is knowledgeable, he is respected. But again, this knowledge, it can be fitna to some. It can be fitna to some. Fitna in form of al-ujub, arrogance. Fitna in form of a sum'ah, you want to be heard. Fitna in form of riyah, you want to be seen. Whatever people do, you want to have your say in it. In one narration, first before that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, halaku ummati fil kitabi wal laban. The destruction of my ummah are in two things. Al-kitabu, that is al-kitab, the book, wal laban, and the milk. The sahabas, they asked, mal kitabu wa mal labanu ya Rasulallah. What do you mean by the two, the book and the milk? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yata'allamuna al-Qur'ana فيتأولونه على غير ما أنزل الله ويحبون اللبن فيدعون الجماعات والجمع ويبدون. The Prophet, to explain to his Sahabas what he meant by Al-Kitabu wal-Laban, he gave his explanation. He said, يقرؤون الكتاب. People shall come and they'll recite the book. They'll understand the meaning of the book. They comprehend it. لكن يتأولونه على غير ما أنزل. They'll give a different interpretation from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant, just to suit their own desires. Yata'awwaluna. Amma al-laban, the milk, the Prophet said, yuhibbuna al-labana, that is wealth in totality. Yuhibbuna al-labana fayada'una al-jama'at. People will have big love, great love, for what? For al-mal. يدعون الجماعات, they'll distance themselves from the Muslim community, from their jama'at, from their akriba. والجمعي, even prayers they'll not attend because they'll be busy with what? Occupied with their businesses. where Badoon, they would like to distance themselves far away from other people. Then جَاءَ فِي الْخَبَرِ عِنْدَ الدَّارِمِي أَنَّ الرَّجُلَ يَأْتِي فِي آخِرِ الزَّمَانِ يَقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ ثُمَّ يَقُولُ لِمَا لَمْ أُتَّبَعْ. Towards the end of time, a person will come, a group of people will appear, those who shall be reciting the Quran. Then by the recitation of the Quran, ثُمَّ يَقُولُ, then they'll start saying, مَا لِي لَا أُتَّبَعْ. Why is it that I do not have any followers? Why aren't there people who are able to listen to me or to follow me? Where are my supporters? Then he says that فَيُحْدِثُ لِلنَّاسِ حَدَثًا لِيَتَّبِعُوهُ وَالْإِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. يُحْدِثُ لِلنَّاسِ حَدَثًا. He shall innovate. He will come with bid'at, muhdathat in this deen, simply because he's looking for followers. And that is the time that you are living today. Finally, in the fourth story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about Dhil Qarnaini, the main lesson we learn from there is fitna to sulta. Fitna to sulta, the trial of being given authority. If you are made the leader, you've been given certain responsibilities, you've been given certain positions, remember this is fitna. Not so many people pass this exam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَهَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ إِن تَوَلَّيْتُمْ أَن تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَتُقَطِعُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهِ فَأَصَمَّهُمْ وَأَعْمَى أَبْصَارًا. فَهَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ, do you think, إِن تَوَلَّيْتُمْ, that if Allah shall give you any authority, and tufsidu fil ardi, you shall commit a lot of mischief in the earth, wa tuqatti'u arhamakum, and you are going to deviate, you are going to severe your kinship, you cut qati'u rahim, you distance yourself from your relatives, simply because you have attained certain positions in the community. Tufsidu fil ard, you increase a lot of fasad in the earth. وَتُقَطِئُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ, you distance yourself because so-and-so has got no position in the community. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهِ, these people Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall curse them. فَأَصَمَّهُمْ, Allah will turn them to be what? They'll not be able to hear. They become deaf. وَأَعْمَى أَبْصَارَهُمْ, Allah will cause them to be blind. They shall not see. They'll not listen. They'll not hear the truth. They'll not see what the truth is. أقول ما تسمعون استغفر الله لي ولكم وللمسلمين فاستغفرونه الغفور الرحيم وهو البر الكريم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد, عباد الله, إن من يقرأ هذه السورة بتأمل وتدبر يعرف هذه الفتن وكيف ينجو منها. الله سبحانه وتعالى in سورة الكهف, he has narrated to us four different stories, and from these stories we said there are a lot of lessons to be learned from them, and today we are talking about some of the fitan which have been mentioned from the four stories. الفتنة الأولى فتنة في الدين. The first fitna is fitna in the deen. The second fitna is fitna في المال, fitna in the wealth. The third fitna is fitna في العلم, in the knowledge, العلم. Then finally الفتنة في السلطة, fitna in authority. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى, being most merciful to the mankind, Allah has highlighted these stories, and He has mentioned to us also tariqatun najat. What is the way out? If these are the issues, these are the dangers that we are being warned from, how can we run away and stay safe from these dangers? The beginning of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts by Alhamdulillahi alladhi anzala ala abdihi alkitaba walam yaj'al lahu iwaja. The beginning of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving praises upon himself for having done what? for having brought down the Quran. So Quran is the first and the most important thing for our Savior, for us to be safe from any form of fitna in this dunya. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told Hudhayfah ibn al-Yamani radiyallahu anhu, when Hudhayfah was always asking about ash-shururi, what are the evils, what are the dangers, what are the things that we need to be careful from, then finally Hudhayfah asked the Prophet, then what is the way out? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned to Hudhayfah radiyallahu anhu that you have to stick to the Quran. Sticking to the Quran laysa mujarrad tilawa, but you have to understand the Quran, what it says. You have to implement the Quran, what it addresses you to do. That is number one. And number two, sunan of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Towards the end of the surah, Allah again is opening our eyes. He says, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Whoever who expects the meeting with his Lord, with Allah, you expect there's al-ba'thu, there's al-nushur, there's al-hisab. فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. You have to do righteous deeds. And any action you perform cannot be classified as righteous unless it is wifqan lihadin Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It has to be in accordance with the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the understanding of as-salafi salihi. Because yes, you could be reading the Quran, you could be reading the sunan, you want to implement the sunnah according to your own understanding. This one also is not safe for you. Look at what the Quran says. What did the Prophet do? How did the Sahabas understand that particular text? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the same stories, after each and every narration, he gives us the way out. About Ashab al-Kahfi, what did they say? Allah says, إِذْ أَوَى الْفِتْيَةُ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. So from fitna to deen, the way out is ad-du'a, al-luju'u ila Allah, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what the Prophet used to do. رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَجْعَلْ مُصِيبَتَنَا فِي دِينِنَا. About fitna to al-mal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after narrating the story, says, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَا إِنْ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ فَأَصْبَحَ هَشِيمًا تَذْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ وكان الله على كل شيء مقتدرا المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. You have to understand the reality that this wealth which Allah has given you, it does not remain with you forever. These possessions that we have in dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us in turns. You're given today, tomorrow it's taken away from you, given to somebody else. We take turns in possessing whatever that we have in this dunya. That is haqiqatul mal, haqiqatul hayati fi dunya. Bal al-mal al-banuna zinatul hayat. All these are decorations. Decoration means it's not something which is original. It's not something which is asl, bal far'. These are just ziyada. Anytime Allah can take them away, then you remain with that asl. So whatever that you have in this dunya, understand, O Muslim, that whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala feels like, he can easily take it away from you. Thirdly, fitnatul ilmi, an-najatu minha as-sabr. The fitna of knowledge, the way out from it is as-sabr. Because Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi salam, when he talks about his beloved brother, he says, Rahimallahu akhi Musa, law annahu sabr. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon my brother Musa alayhi salam. Only if he could have been patient. You can never acquire any knowledge if you're not patient. You can never succeed. You can never receive or acquire any beneficial knowledge if you do not have a sabr. But the starting point is al-ikhlas. So whoever who shall acquire knowledge just because he wants to be seen, to be heard, or to do this or that, this person, what is lacking in his life is not, is a sabr. Then finally, fitna to as-sulta is you need to acknowledge that whatever that you have is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Dhulqarnaini, after he did what he did for his people, then he said, Hadha rahmatun min Rabbi. Hadha rahmatun min Rabbi. فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعْدُ رَبِّي جَعَلَهُ دَكَّاءَ وَكَانَ وَعْدُ رَبِّي حَقًّا. He did not associate it to himself that all this that I've done for you is because I'm capable of doing so. But he said, هَذَا مِنْ رَحْمَةُ رَبِّي. All these are from the benevolence of who? Of my Lord. أَلَا فَصَلُّ وَسَلِّمُ عَلَى الْمَبُوثِ رَحْمَةَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ فَقَدْ أَمَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِهَا قَائِلَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَلَائِكَةَ يُسَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وارض اللهم عن خلفاء الأربعة أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر صحابة رسول الله وتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداءك أعداء الدين اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة برحمتك أرحم الراحمين والحمد لله رب العالمين قوموا للصلاة